1,000 rupees as profit, and the businessman keeps 40%. That is 24,000 rupees of the profit. So bigger the profit, bigger is the share for the Islamic bank as well as the businessman. Lesser is the profit, lesser is the share for the businessman and the bank. But suppose the businessman goes in loss. The complete loss is borne by the Islamic bank. And the bank in turn passes that loss to the depositor. But technically, even the businessman going in loss for his thinking, for the time he has wasted, 6 months, etc., he has been paid for the labor but not for the other charges, for his thinking, for his whatever ideas he had. Technically, even he's going in loss. The major difference in Mudaraba system is that the bank has no right to interfere with the management of the business of the entrepreneur. It can take accountability every month, every week, no problem, how the business is running. But it can't interfere with the management. Suppose the businessman wants to build a building of 10 stories. So the bank cannot say, instead of 10 stories, build more, 12 stories. You can't interfere with the business. Instead of using A-grade cement, you use B-grade cement for more profit. The bank cannot interfere with the management of the businessman in the Mudaraba system. The second type of trading is called as a Musharika system. It's called as partnership. In this, the bank has a right to interfere with the management of the business. It can give guidance. It can tell that instead of producing a particular article, you can produce another article. Instead of building a 10-story building, you build a 12-story building. In this system of Musharika, the businessman has got part of the capital. The part of the capital it takes from the bank. Now, depending upon the ratio of investment, suppose both have paid 50%, 50% capital is paid by the businessman, 50% capital is paid by the bank. Whatever profit is there is again shared in the ratio which is predetermined. Say for example, it's 50%, 50%. Whatever profit the people make, 50% goes to the bank, 50% goes to the businessman. If there is loss, the loss is also shared on a predetermined ratio. In the Mudaraba system, the loss is completely borne by the bank. In the Musharika system, the loss is shared on a predetermined ratio. Though the ratio is different from the sharing of profit. Suppose the sharing of profit is 50% by the bank, 50% by the businessman, the sharing of loss is at a different ratio. The bank bears more loss. For example, the bank, if the business goes in loss, the bank will share 60% of the loss and the businessman will share 40% of the loss. This is the Musharika system. The third type is the Murhaba. In the Murhaba system, suppose you want to purchase a particular machinery from Japan. The machinery costs 1 lakh rupees. In the modern bank, you open an LC, a letter of credit, or a TR, called trust receipt, and you put the money in the bank, and the bank buys the machinery from Japan, the modern bank, and whatever time it takes for the transaction, it charges a fixed interest on that. In the Islamic bank, you put the amount in the Islamic bank. The businessman, since he does not want to go to Japan to buy the machinery, he tells the Islamic bank, you buy the machinery for me, on my behalf. So you put that money as wakala in the bank, 1 lakh rupees, or whatever the amount is, you put. And the Islamic bank buys the machinery on behalf of the businessman. And the Islamic bank, when it gets the machinery, it has a right to charge a profit, a commission or service charge, whatever you call it. Say the Islamic bank says that we buy the machinery for 1 lakh rupees from Japan, when we give it to you in Bombay, we want 3,000 rupees profit, or 3,000 rupees commission, or 3,000 rupees service charge. Islam gives permission. It's called in the Islamic terminology as ujara. It's allowed in Islam. Profit is allowed. But this profit can be negotiable. The businessman can say, instead of 3,000, you take a profit of 2,500, or whatever it is. The profit is negotiable. Suppose you have part of the finance, or you don't have finance at all for purchasing that particular machinery, you can interlink, you can combine Murhaba system with the Mudariba or with Musharika. For example, you have part of the money, or you have no finance at all. Say you don't have 1 lakh at all. You tell the Islamic bank, I want to purchase that money, I want to purchase that machinery for 1 lakh rupees, and after it comes to Bombay, I will make a profit of say 20,000 rupees on that machinery. Now they're dealing a transaction of Mudariba, that the Islamic bank buys the machinery and gives it to the businessman, and the businessman says that within few months or within a few days, I will sell that machinery and get a profit of 20,000 rupees. That profit is shared between the bank and the businessman and the Mudarib on a ratio which is predetermined. For example, the bank says, since they are giving 100% finance, we want 60% profit. The 20% profit goes to the businessman since he is not putting a single pie. So out of the 20,000 profit that the businessman takes, that he makes, besides returning the 1 lakh rupees capital, he also gives back a profit of 60% of the 20,000 rupees, say rupees 12,000. And the remaining 40%, remaining 8,000, he keeps for himself. This is called as the Mudariba along with Murhaba. The other is the Musharika along with Murhaba, that the businessman has part of the finance. Say, of the 1 lakh rupees, he has 50,000 rupees. So, he says 50,000 invested by the bank, 50,000 by the businessman. And whatever profit they have is again divided on the ratio that is predetermined. There's another system in the Islamic banking called as ijara. In the modern terminology, it can be called as leasing or hire purchase. That suppose you don't want to buy that machinery or vehicle. Suppose there's a car you want for 2 lakh rupees. You don't want to buy it. You just want to rent it. So the Islamic bank says, we are willing to rent this vehicle. Rent the Maruti car which cost about 2 lakh rupees to you. And the rent is based on the lifespan of that vehicle. Say suppose Maruti van or Maruti car can last for 5 years. And the Islamic bank says, I want a profit of 1 lakh rupees. So the cost price of the car, 2 lakh rupees, is added with the profit they want, 1 lakh rupees, 3 lakh. It's going, the car will run for 5 years, that is 60 months. So the 3 lakh rupees amount, the cost plus the profit is divided equally between 60 months. It comes to 5,000 rupees. So you rent that Maruti car to that businessman for 5,000 rupees per month. That businessman is not interested in buying the car. If the businessman says, after 3 years, I may have part of the money to buy it back. It's called as ijara ending with sale. So the bank will say, the Islamic bank, for 3 years we want a profit of 80,000 rupees. So 2 lakh of the car, add 80,000 comes to 2 lakh 80,000 rupees. He keeps on paying 5,000 rupees every month. At the end of 3 years, he pays approximately 1 lakh 80,000 rupees. Still 1 lakh is due. So the businessman pays that 1 lakh rupees lump sum to the Islamic bank and buys the car. So in the Islamic banking system, there is renting ijara along with buying back facility. In the modern bank, the car is on your name, it's only hypothecated to the bank. And the modern bank will never buy back the car. In the Islamic bank, if you don't want the car remains with the Islamic bank. So the businessman, when he takes a loan from Islamic Bank has the option of buying back the car or keeping the car with the bank. Coming to the last type of system in Islamic Bank is Karz-e Hasan. Karz means loan, Hasan means beautiful. That is, loan is given to a person who's poor without interest. There is no equivalent of Karz-e Hasan in any system of modern banking. There's nothing like interest-free loan in the modern bank at all. My Islamic bank, for example, Malaysia, 10% of the profit, they keep it separately for Karz-e Hasan. This fund is given to the poor people who are encouraged to do business. Say, suppose they want 2,000 rupees or 5,000 rupees or whatever amount for a period of 1 year or 2 years. The bank will say, okay, we give you 5,000 rupees or 10,000 rupees for 2 years. You do business and return that money back to us after 2 years. But national guarantees are taken if possible. If the businessman who's poor goes in a profit, if he wants, he can give part of the profit to the bank. If he does not want, he need not give. He is not forced to give a single pie extra than the money he has taken. Willingly, if he wants to give a part of it to you, to the bank, he's most willing. But technically, he has to only return the amount he has taken back. This is called as Karz-e Hasan. And the reference is given in the Quran, in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 245. That who will loan to Allah a beautiful loan, which Allah will double and multiply unto his account. The word Karz-e Hasan is mentioned in the Quran, that if you want to give a loan to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah will multiply it, increase it many number of times. And I'd like to end my talk by giving a quotation from the Quran, from Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 261, which says, the parable of those who spend their substance in the way of Allah is that of a grain of corn. It grows 7 years, each year bearing 100 corn. The Quran says that those who spend their substance in the way of Allah, the parable is that of a grain of corn. It goes 7 years, 7 bhutas. Each year having 100 corn means 1 corn becomes 700 times. One corn, one grain of corn is converted to 700 corns if you spend it in the way of Allah. In short, Allah promises you 700 times profit. In business terminology, you'll say 70,000% profit. I want to know which business in the world today can give you a profit of 70,000%. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promises you that I will give you 70,000% profit, 700 times profit. And Allah does not stop at that. He says, I will give you many fold times more. But for you to do business with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you have to have taqwa. You have to have faith. You have to have righteousness. You have to have God consciousness. The best bank that you can invest is in the bank of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's the best bank. But natural to invest in that bank, you require taqwa, you require God consciousness, you require piety. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.
Thank you for that, Jazakallah Khair, for that very educative talk on the subject of the day. Now we have the question and answer session, in which we have an open forum for the audience to put questions to Dr. Zakir Naik on the topic of the day, interest-free economy promulgated by the Quran. You may ask only one question at a time. Kindly be brief and to the point. This is a question answer time, not a lecture time. Put forward a question and you'd get a response to that. We have mic arrangements here. For the gents, we have Brother Imran, who runs down the aisle with the mic. Anyone requiring to ask a question, would like to ask a question, may kindly raise his hand, and as per a direction, he would be passing on the mic. In the ladies section, We would request the person coordinating there, Sister Farah or whoever, to kindly tap 3 times on the mic there like this. So I know a questioner is ready there and we give them the opportunity. Or she could interject and request when appropriate. We start the question and answer session with the brother there in the center.
Dr. Zakir Naik, I want to ask you about the time period you quoted that suppose for 2 years a certain amount has been invested in the bank. And suppose the entrepreneur fails to earn a profit or a loss in the 2 years and it takes time. So the bank is liable to take the money back or not?
The brother posed the question that suppose the bank, Islamic bank, gives a particular amount for 2 years and that businessman fails to make any profit or loss in that 2 years, does the bank have the right to take back the money? It depends upon the condition. If the term fixed for the loan taken from the Islamic bank is 2 years, then the bank has a right to take back the money, irrespective whether it makes a profit or loss. But if the bank feels that if another 6 months is given to the businessman, maybe he will make a profit, the bank can surely extend the period to 2.5 years or to 3 years, depending upon how productive is the business. It depends on the discretion of the bank. Hope that answers the question. But the main difference is that if the loss is there, the businessman in the Mudaraba system does not bear the loss. The loss is borne by the bank. So the businessman is yet not going any loss, direct loss. The loss is borne by the Islamic bank. Hope that answers the question.
Excuse me, my question to you is in connection with the housing loan and all that is given to people by the banks. Could you please tell what is the system under the Islamic law, under the Islamic banking, which helps people to obtain at least a shelter for themselves?
Brother posed the question that suppose a person, he wants to buy a house, and if he wants a loan, how does the modern bank differs in giving loan for housing as compared to the Islamic bank? The main difference is that in the modern bank, suppose you want a loan for buying a house, but naturally you should have a particular percentage. It may be 25% or 50% of that house, or 40%, whatever the bank has its rules, you have to pay of that house. 25%, 40% or 50% of that house, initially you have to pay. The remaining balance, 75% or 60% or 50%, it's paid by the bank. And suppose the house cost for 3 lakhs, but cost for 4 lakhs. The initial 1 lakh you paid, the remaining 3 lakh is paid by the modern bank. And say you want a time period of 5 years. So the modern bank take into account that 3 lakh loan has been taken from the modern bank. You will be repaying it in 3 years' time. And the interest rate for 3 years is calculated, whatever the amount will be. It may be 40,000 or 50,000 rupees. So it calculates the initial loan it has given you plus the interest. Say the interest is about 50,000. So the 3 lakh loan and 50,000 interest is paid in a period of 3 years. 3,50,000 is paid in installments. This 3,50,000 is divided by the number of months. That is 36 months. So every month you pay an installment of say somewhere around close to 10,000 rupees, 9,500, whatever it is, you pay. So the system of the modern bank is based on interest. The amount it has given you loan and the time period you take, the loan plus interest is the installments you pay. But naturally, since it involves riba, it involves interest, it is haram in Islam. The system of the Islamic banking is different. There are various different types of systems. The loan that you take from the Islamic bank, there are various ways in which you can take loans. Different banks have got different schemes. Some banks have the scheme that suppose you pay part. Again, you have to pay 25% or 40% or 50% of the initial amount of that flat. Out of 4 lakh, you pay 1 lakh. The remaining 3 lakh is given to you by the Islamic bank. Now the Islamic bank calculates that what is the average monthly rent of that house? Say, it may be about 15,000 per month. Since you have paid 25% of the initial amount of that house and 75% is paid by the Islamic Bank, the rent is divided. 25% of the rent you don't pay, the remaining 75% you pay. Whatever the amount comes to, every month. Since 75% of the house has been financed by the Islamic Bank, 25% by you. So here, you calculate the rent. And at the end of 3 years, they see to it that suppose they want a particular profit. So the Islamic Bank says, I want a profit of about 40,000 rupees. I want a profit of 30,000 rupees at the end of 3 months. So 3 lakhs they have given to you. Plus the 30,000 is added as profit. The 3.3 lakh is divided in the 36 months as installments. But here, it is not calculated on interest, it is calculated on profit. And every month you're paying rent. Every month you're paying rent of that house. That's one of the ways of taking loans. For example, if you go in the Alameen Bank, they have Ashiana scheme, housing scheme, where you must, suppose you say that after 4 years I'm going to get married, after 3 years I'm going to get married. They encourage you to start saving from now. So every month you can deposit either 1,000 rupees, 2,000 rupees or 3,000 rupees of that amount in the Alameen Bank. It goes in the Ashiana scheme. And whatever you deposit, it is invested in the Mudaraba system. And you get profit on that. So at the end of 3 years, every year you keep on depositing 3,000 rupees, whatever it is. At the end of 3 years, it becomes 3 multiplied by 36. It becomes more than 1 lakh rupees. 1,08,000. And plus the profit. With the profit, it comes to 1,25,000 or 1,50,000. So now, the remaining 1.5 lakh is given to you by the Alameen Bank. On the same basis. Which is based on the rent. It's based on profit, it's not based on interest. So anything we deal with interest is haram. Anything we deal with profit and loss is allowed. Hope that answers the question.
Any question from the ladies side?
Assalamu alaikum. What are we supposed to do with the interest money we have? Some says you can utilize the interest money for constructing toilet and bathroom.
The sister posed the question that what are we supposed to do with the interest money we have? Some say that you can utilize that money for constructing bathrooms and toilets. Firstly, as a Muslim, you should not involve yourself in interest at all. So if you don't involve yourself in interest, the question of you having interest money does not arise. You are not supposed to keep a single pie in any institute, in any bank which deals with interest. So if you don't keep your money in interest-based institute, you will not have interest money, so the question will not arise, where are you supposed to invest that money? Suppose, today you have decided that today I've realized that interest is haram. It is prohibited. And you say, okay, I will refrain from it. If a person has to repent, there are 3 criteria required. First, he should realize the thing he is doing is haram. It is prohibited. Second, he should stop it immediately. Third, he should not involve in it in future. So today if you realize that interest is haram, and if you have some money remaining with you, then I would say that spend it in the way of Allah. But if you say, I will keep my money in the modern bank in the fixed deposit, on the savings account, and whatever money I get regularly, whatever money I get every year, I will give it in the way of constructing toilets, constructing bathrooms. Some say you can spend it on footwear. From where they get this, I don't know. Interest is haram, and the money of that interest is also haram. I would like to ask a question, that suppose there's a person who's dealing in drugs, who's dealing in cocaine and brown sugar. Since intoxicant has been prohibited in the Quran, he says that I have invested 1 lakh rupees in this business of cocaine, of drug. So I've invested 10 lakh rupees. After investing 10 lakh rupees, every month I get a profit of 1 lakh rupees. And that 1 lakh profit, since dealing in drugs is haram, I don't take a single pie of the profit. I spend that 1 lakh rupees for the poor people. Do you think it's allowed in Islam? But naturally it's not allowed. That since the consumption of intoxicants is haram, dealing in intoxicants is also haram. You can't say that as a compensation, whatever profit I've got, I spend it for good deed. It's not allowed. In the same fashion, you cannot say I will keep my money in a modern bank, in the saving account or fixed deposit, and whatever money I have, I will spend it on making chappals and building toilets. Same smuggler will say that after I make a profit of 1 lakh rupees, I will make one toilet in every locality. Do you think it's allowed? He may, in his business of dealing with drugs, he may have ruined hundreds and thousands of lives, which may be costing more than crores of rupees. This 1 lakh is negligible. So you can't compensate by saying, whatever money I have, I will spend it for building bathrooms or chapels. Interest is haram. You are not supposed to keep your money in any institute which involves with interest. So if you don't have the money, the question of spending it does not arise. But today, if you have decided that interest is haram, and whatever backlog you have, inshallah, you can spend in the way of Allah, and Allah will accept it. I hope that answers the question.
Next question.
Zakir bhai, you have very well proved that taking interest is prohibited in the Quran and Hadith. I do agree with it. But is giving interest also haram?
Brother said that he agrees that since the Quran mentions taking of interest is haram, he says that is giving of interest also haram? It is that you asked me the question, that since the Quran clearly mentions that intoxicants and gambling, it mentions Surah Maida, chapter number 5, verse number 90. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, O you who believe, innamal khamru al maisuru, more certainly intoxicants and gambling. Wal anzabu al aslamu, dedication of stones, divination of arrows. Rujtum min amali shaitan, these are abomination of Satan's handiwork. Fashtanibu lalakum tuflihun, abstain from such abomination that you may prosper. Since the Quran says alcohol is prohibited, and if I say that okay, consuming alcohol is prohibited, selling is allowed, but natural dealing in any activity of alcohol is prohibited, since the Quran prohibits it. But there are further details given in various hadiths. For example, if you refer to the hadith narrated by Anas, may Allah be pleased with him, he said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cursed 10 groups of people who deal with alcohol. The one who distills it, the one for whom it is distilled, the one who drinks it, the one who transports it, the one who transports it, the one to whom it is brought, the one who sells it, the one who serves it, the one who utilizes the money out of it, the one who buys it, and the one to whom it is bought for. All 10 categories of people will be cursed. So when the Quran says it is prohibited, it is prohibited. Same way, I do agree. Quran says in various places, devour not usury, eat not usury, take not usury. So but natural taking is prohibited. But if you would have analyzed, if you would have paid attention, I also mentioned a verse from the Quran, from Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 275, which says that trade is like usury. They say, trade is like usury. Tell them, Allah has permitted trade, but forbidden usury. Here it does not mention taking or giving. All sorts of dealing in usury is prohibited. And for more detail, you can refer to the Hadith of Sahih Bukhari, volume number 3, chapter number 628, Hadith number 3880, which says that Abdullah bin Masud, may Allah be pleased with him, he said that Allah's Messenger, may peace be upon him, he cursed the person who took riba, the person who took interest, and the person who gave interest. In the next hadith, immediately later on, of Sahih Muslim, volume 3, chapter number 628, Hadith number 3881. It says that Jabir, may Allah be pleased with him, he said that the Messenger of Allah, may peace be upon him, said the curse of Allah is on the person who is the taker of interest, who takes interest, who gives interest, who records interest, and those two witnesses involved, all are equal. The person who gives interest is cursed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The one who takes interest, the one who records it, is cursed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also the two witnesses, even they are cursed, for all are equal. Hope that answers the question.
Hello. Yeah. In order to prevent myself from taking interest, why don't I invest in a current account that does not involve any interest? So how is that different from an Islamic account?
Brother posed the question that what is the difference between the current account of a modern bank and a current account of an Islamic bank? You can't invest your money in current account because current account does not have any returns. You can keep your money in current account for safekeeping. There's no problem. Islamically wise, if you keep your money in the current account of a modern bank, directly it is not prohibited since it does not deal with interest. But logically, I can give you several reasons why keeping your money in the current account of an Islamic bank is more beneficial than a current account of a modern bank. Firstly, though there is no returns in the current account of a modern bank or Islamic bank, there's no returns, no profit, no interest involved, but still, the money that you keep in the modern bank can be utilized for projects which are harmful for society. For example, making gambling dens or making alcohol factories, all such projects. So in short, you are helping the bank to make the society more bad. If you keep your money in the Islamic current account of an Islamic bank, not a single project will be financed which is harmful to society. All the projects that they finance are permitted by the Sharia. So Muslim will be satisfied. But non-Muslim, he's not bothered of society. He's saying, I care a hand of the society that goes to the dog. I'm only bothered about the safety of my money. So what's the difference keeping the money in an Islamic bank and a modern bank? Just in case, if you keep your money in a modern bank, and if the bank goes bankrupt, according to the laws of the modern bank, the creditors of the bank get their money first. The depositors get later on. By the time the creditors are paid whatever is due to them, the money is exhausted. So if you keep your money in a modern bank, and if the bank goes bankrupt, there are high chances you will not get your money back. But if you keep your money in an Islamic bank, according to the Islamic Sharia law, the depositors get their money first. So if you keep your money in an Islamic bank, and even if God forbid that bank goes bankrupt, you will get your money back. Hope that answers the question. So even economically wise, keeping in the current account of a modern of Islamic bank is more safer as compared to keeping in the current account of a modern bank. Hope that answers the question.
The next question from the lady side.
Isn't the service charge taken by the Islamic bank similar to the interest charged by the modern bank? Is it in the same concept with the change of words to attract the Muslims?
Sister posed the question that isn't the service charge taken by the Islamic bank the same as the interest charged by the modern bank with the change of word just to attract the Muslims as a bait. Theoretically, if you analyze, the interest charged today by the modern bank, it is about 11%, it is about 14% to 15%. It varies, depends upon a project. 14 to 18%, sometimes it's 20%. If you want a loan, a particular loan for a particular project, etc. And if you go to Islamic bank, Islamic bank has a service charge. Take for example, the service charge charged by the Barakat Investment. So, the Baitul Nasar. the Barkat investment and Baitul Nasr. It is varying from 8% to 15%. It varies 8 to 15%. But in the past few years, it is somewhat similar to 14%. So even if you agree that 16% interest charged by the modern bank is somewhat similar to the 14% charged by the Islamic bank as service charge, it's one and the same, 19-20 ka farak hai, difference of just a few percentage here and there. But the basic concept is the same. It is same as interest, only a change of words. First, you have to analyze that the service charge charged by the Islamic Financial Institute is based on the profit and loss which the Islamic bank has. It's not based on interest. In the modern bank, the interest rate is fixed. If it is 16, it will remain 16. In the Islamic bank, the service charge that they take is based on the profit and loss of the full year of that particular company or that institute. And say, for example, the profit and loss, it comes to approximately 13% or 14%. So initially they charge 14%. At the end of the year, they actually calculate the amount of loss and profit in which they have gone. And based on that, the last monthly installment is given. If instead of 14%, if they're supposed to be 15%, the last installment will be very big. If instead of 14%, they're supposed to be 12%, the last installment will be negligible. It fluctuates. But one thing we should realize, that if supposed today, the Islamic concept of banking is not very famous. Suppose only two people come every day to the Islamic bank for taking loan. Now whatever money is deposited in a saving account, etc., and different account by the depositors, they are given as loan to you. In that bank, 10 people are working. So, but natural, the service charge that they charge you will be depending upon the profit which they're giving to the savings account plus the administration cost of the 10 people which are working in the bank. So if only two people come every day to that bank, the 10 people's salary will be divided between the two people. But suppose tomorrow the system gets famous and instead of two people, 100 people come to the bank. The staff will only have to be increased, say, by twice. Instead of 10, they'll have to give 20 staff. So the salary of 20 people will be divided into 100 people. The service charge will go down. So if more people have faith in the Islamic system of banking, but naturally the service charge will come down, and they're trying their level best to bring it to as low as 8 to 9%, which they will. But one thing we should realize, that if you analyze, if you keep in a fixed deposit account in an Islamic investment company, say the Barkat investment, No investment today in India is a full-fledged Islamic bank, because the RBI does not give it permission to function as a bank. They can only function as an investment financial institute. They can't issue checks. The RBI does not give it permission. Whatever little bit Islamic banking they are following, the Islamic investment, for example, the Barkat investment, if you put your money in the system of Musharaka or Mudareba, fixed deposit, they give you a return of between 16 to 20%, and the cost shows that once they gave 16, once they gave 17.5, once they gave 19. Say, for example, Barkat investment gave 19% profit. The service charge that the bank is charging you if you take a loan from Baitul Nasr, which is the sister concern of Barkat investment, they are only charging you 14%. So if you are clever, what you can do, you can keep your 1 lakh rupees invested in Barkat investment. Get 19,000 rupees out of 1 lakh rupees. Fine. And same time, since you want that 1 lakh rupees back, you can also take a loan from Baitul Nasr on the deposit which you have of 1 lakh rupees and pay only 14% of service charge. So indirectly, when you keep your 1 lakh rupees, you are getting a return of 19,000 rupees. That same 1 lakh can also be obtained on the same day from Baitul Nasr. And you're paying only 14%, 14,000. At the end of year, without involving a little bit risk also, you're making a profit of 5,000 rupees. But they see to it that people don't try and fool. But if you analyze, the profit that you get from the Barkat investment is 19%. The service charge is 14%. It's not related at all. In the modern bank, it is related. It is directly related. That the interest which the bank pays on fixed deposit may be 10 to 11%. And when you take a loan, they charge 16%. The person who takes a loan always pays 4 to 5% more than what they give to the depositors. In the Islamic bank, it did not be that same. So service charge and the interest is a world of a difference. If you want to lower the service charge, what we have to do? We have to convince more Muslims to have faith in this bank and invest more money. Inshallah, service charge will come down. I hope that answers the question.
Next question.
Assalamu alaikum. Dr. Bakre, he studied the economic system of Vedas. He says that in the Vedas there is also same economic system, interest free economy, and he also claims that you implement in India that system, the economic imbalance, we can make our society economically balanced. So exactly in Vedas, actually same system of economic is there. If there is a same system as of Quran, then can we say that writer of that Veda is one of the prophets of Islam?
Brother, pose the question. Person by the name of Dr. Bakar. Bakre. That's why the correct pronunciation is M.G. Bokre. He has said that even the Veda speaks about an interest-free economy. Is it the same as mentioned in the Quran? And if it's the same, is the author of the Vedas one of the prophets of God? Here in the first question, is it the same? I do agree that even the Vedas do specify about an interest-free economy. Even the Quran specifies the same. How you implement it can be differ. It can differ. As long as the system you're running is an interest-free system, the way of method of running can differ. This method has been devised by various people, which they have read various historical books from the hadiths and the implementation of the various economists. Even the Vedas say it should be interest-free. As long as the economy is interest-free, inshallah, it will be sustainable. Regarding the second part of the question, that if it's the same, does it mean that the Veda is a revelation of God, or does it mean that the author of the Veda is the prophet of God? One thing you should realize, that before the Quran was revealed, there were several other revelations that came on the face of the earth. By name we know four: the Torah, the Zabur, the Injil, and the Furqan. The Furqan is the Quran. The Torah is the revelation which we believe, a wahi which was revealed to Musa alayhi salam, Moses may peace be upon him. A Zabur is the wahi, is the revelation which was revealed to Dawud alayhi salam, David may peace be upon him. Injil is the wahi, is the revelation revealed to Isa alayhi salam, Jesus may peace be upon him. And Furqan, that is the Quran, is the last and final revelation which was revealed to the last and final messenger Muhammad, may peace be upon him. Before this, maybe many revelations were there which we do not know name of. Four, we surely know by name. Messengers in the Quran are mentioned 25 by name: Adam, Abraham, Moses, David, Solomon, Jesus, Muhammad, may peace be upon them all. My name 25. In the hadiths, we find 99 by name. But there were more than 120,000 prophets and messengers. As the Quran says, we have sent to every nation and a guide. Every nation we have sent a guide. The same way, there can be other scriptures also revealed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not written by prophets, revealed by Allah. But if you ask me, if a few points coincide in the Bible and the Quran, can you say Bible is the word of God? If a few points coincide with the Vedas, can you say it's the word of God? No, you cannot say. You cannot say. If a few points are coinciding, what you can say, it can be from God, maybe it's not from God. Even if it's from God, you don't have to agree with it. It's not the it's not the last and final revelation. The last revelation is the Quran. And Quran clearly states in Surah Baqarah chapter number 2, verse number 106, we have substituted our signs with other signs which are similar or better. Even if a few things matches the Quran, you can say maybe they are remnants of the word of God. For example, there are many things which in the Bible which match with the Quran. What we can say? That maybe the Bible contains, partly it contains the word of God. It may contain a few verses of the Injil. But we can't say the full Bible is the word of God. Same way neither can we say the Veda is the word of God. Maybe it contains a few revelations from God. Maybe, I'm not saying surely. Bible I can say surely, few words of Injil, because the word Injil is mentioned in the Quran that it is a revelation of God. Regarding Veda, it's not mentioned in the Quran. So maybe it is. Even if it is, we don't have to bother. We have to believe in the last and final revelation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that is the Quran. Hope that answers the question.
Dr. Zakir Naik, how about working in the bank?
So that's the question, how about working in the bank? Okay, I'm a Muslim, work in a modern bank. Bank means modern or Islamic? Which bank, modern bank or Islamic bank? Modern bank. The brother wants to know that is it fine, is it okay if you work in a modern bank? As I mentioned, anything dealing with riba is prohibited. Whether you give riba or take riba or record riba. I'd given a quotation from Sahih Muslim, volume number 3, chapter number 628, hadith number 3881, which says that Jabir, may Allah be pleased with him, he said that Allah's messenger, may peace be upon him, cursed those people who took interest, who gave interest, who recorded it, and the two witnesses, all are alike. All are cursed. In the bank, you are recording the witness. So from Sahih Muslim, it is clearly prohibited. Working in a modern bank is prohibited. Anyone who gives a witness, giving a surety is also prohibited. But if you ask me that today you are working in a modern bank, what am I to do? I wouldn't tell you that leave immediately. If you have any other option, alhamdulillah, leave it immediately. Because what you should do, you should try and find another substitute. You should leave the job which you're doing and find another job. But unfortunately, I know many people who say that I want to leave the modern bank since 2 years. I've got no option. The reason is, today they're drawing 4,000 rupees salary per month. They are getting other jobs, but they're getting only 3,000 rupees. Instead of saying that I do not get a salary equivalent to the salary I get in modern bank, they say they have got no option. Of course they have an option. They can surely look for other jobs, but they are afraid that instead of earning 4,000, they will earn 3,000. So in short, they want to make more money. And they're challenging Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for a war. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his Rasul. So, if you're working in a modern bank, what I'd advise you, that as soon as possible, try and find another job. Even if it's less paying, inshallah, you may never know, you may get a much higher salary paid job later on. Or even if you don't get in this life, you will surely get the reward in the hereafter. You will not be among the companions of the hellfire, and you will get minimum 700 times a turn if you spend in the way of Allah. But if today, if you say that I am working in a modern bank so that I understand the system of the modern economics, so in future, after a year or so, I can start an Islamic bank. If your niyat is to start an Islamic bank, for that you are in a modern bank, then inshallah Allah will forgive you. Because the main intention is to learn the modern economics so that you can implement the Islamic economic in a better way. In the same fashion, if you say that is it fine working in an alcohol shop, I would say it's haram. But if you say, I want to work in that alcohol shop for 2-3 months so that later on I can stop that alcohol shop or convert it into a medical store, I feel, inshallah, Allah will support you. So if you're working in the bank to convert that modern bank to Islamic bank, inshallah, I'll forgive you. But if you work it only for the salary, if you work in that bank only for the salary, Allah will never forgive you. Hope that answers the question.
Question from the ladies' side. Kiran, yeah.
Dr. Naik, in the Quran, riba is mentioned, and riba means usury. So interest can be a part of riba, and there are other parts that is for forms of usury. So if a project is to be passed, for trade is going on, and there are various bureaucratic circles here in India, we've got to pass through their projects, and it requires bribes and all that. So if in doing so, if we put that money into that and return, we get the profit by giving bribes and okaying the thing from the officer and all. And is that usury or what?
Let us pose the question that since we are living in a system which involves a lot of interest, and if we involve, if you do a business project, whatever riba money you get, you can use it for bribing.
No, the question is that suppose we take the money from a bank, from an Islamic bank, and we, for a business, and for the...
Take the money from Islamic bank.
From an Islamic bank, and if we want to pass some projects and all, it goes into the bureaucratic circles, and we've got to pay some bribe from that, from that money. So that, is that money also, that profit comes, it comes into account or riba or what?
Is bribing allowed or not, in short? If whatever money you take from the bank, with that halal money from the bank, can you bribe? In short, can you account it?
Yeah.
I mean, suppose if I total make a profit 50,000 rupees, or a 50,000 rupees profit, I've given 5,000 rupees bribe. So can you say that into 50,000 profit, I've got 45,000 rupees thousand profit? Correct? Into 50,000, 5,000 goes for bribe. So deduct that from the profit, and the balance profit, net profit is only 45,000 rupees. Correct? Brother, firstly, you should realize that bribing is haram in Islam, irrespective of whether it's some haram money or halal money. Accountability comes later on. Accountability comes later on. You're not allowed to bribe. It's clearly mentioned in the Quran, in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 188. It says that squander not your wealth amongst yourself in vanities, not use it, nor use it as a bait to the judges. Bait to the judges means bribe. Do not use your wealth as a bait to the judges, so that you may eat up other people's property, knowingly or unknowingly. You give a bribe so that you eat other people's property. It's haram in Islam. Quran prohibits it in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 188. And again, it says giving bribery is haram. You say, can I take bribery? Again, refer to the hadith. It's clearly mentioned in the hadith of Ahmad that anyone who takes bribe, who gives bribe, and the middle man, all three are cursed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So bribing is haram. The question does not arise whether you can account for it or not. Islamically wise, you can't bribe. If you tell that Islamic banker, I'm going to bribe, he'll say, then don't take the money. In India, they may allow you, I don't know. The Islamic Sharia, actual Sharia, if you say, I want to use that money for making an alcohol factory, it's haram. Alcohol is haram, you can't utilize that money for alcohol factory. If you say, I want to utilize the money for bribing, and in the Islamic law, you can't use that money for bribing. Unknowingly do it, if you cheat them, fine, you can't cheat Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So bribing is haram, irrespective whether it's accountable or not, it's haram. Hope that answers the question.
Yeah, a question from the lady side.
Is insurance allowed in Islam, especially life insurance? If not, is there any other alternative or any Islamic solution to it?
Sister posed the question that is life insurance allowed? Is insurance allowed? Especially life insurance. And if it's not allowed, is there any other alternative or is there any other solution? The concept of insurance is a very old concept. The people of the community, they pull in the money, and the money is utilized at the 11th hour. Maybe you have an accident and case of emergency, that pooled money is utilized. It's a very good concept. But coming to life insurance, is it allowed? According to a fatwa given by Maulana Muhammad Abu Zahar of Egypt, he said that insurance on cars for its repair is lawful, though in itself it is unlawful. The insurance on the cars for its repairs is lawful, though in itself it is unlawful. Overall, it's allowed. As a system, insurance, the way it operates is unlawful. But for cars and repairs, it's allowed. But life insurance, in which you give a monthly installment, and if any mishap takes place, you get your full amount or double the amount. And at the end, if you survive, you get your full amount along with profit. This is nothing but riba. So in short, any investment, whether it be life insurance or car insurance or property insurance, if it involves riba, it is haram. any investment which deals riba, it's haram. Today that we have today, the life insurance corporation, as far as my knowledge goes, the major of the investment is in fixed money market. That is, it is interest based. So whatever money, suppose you record a policy of about 1 lakh for about 10 years. So each year you keep on paying 1 lakh rupees. Each year. So each month you pay an installment of a particular 1,000 rupees. And if you die of an accident in between, even though you have paid only 2 months installment, you get double the amount. You get 20 lakh rupees. If you die a natural death, you get the full amount before maturity. But if you survive for 10 years without dying, you get your full 10 lakh rupees along with profit. Now, where do they give this profit from? The major investment of the life insurance corporation here is in fixed money market, which is riba based, interest based, it's haram. If you know of any institute which gives insurance which is not based on money market but based on shares, equity, it's allowed. Recently, a few days ago, I came across a form called the Golden Bond, which operates in London, in England. There, you invest an amount. The minimum amount that you have to invest there is £2,500. That's about 1.25 lakh rupees. And after you invest that amount, they take that money and invest it in shares and equity, which is allowed in Islam. Shares and equity. They don't invest in fixed money market. And they say that they will give you a return of approximately 7.5%. Approximately. And they give an additional facility that in case if you die, you get an extra bonus. So these sort of investment, which does not deal with riba, it's allowed. But the present life insurance, as far as my knowledge goes, it deals mainly in fixed money market, which is not allowed. It is haram. Insurance not dealing in fixed money market, not dealing with riba, it's allowed. If you're dealing with riba, it's haram. This is in short. Regarding, is there any alternative? Is there an Islamic solution? Can you have a life insurance company based only on the Sharia? Like how you have the Islamic banking based on Sharia, can you have a life insurance company based only on Sharia? Yes, why not? You can have. And a very good solution was given by Mufti Muhammad Shafi of Karachi, Darul Ulm, of Pakistan. He said that we can surely have a life insurance system based on the Islamic Sharia. He says that how you give monthly premium, monthly installment life insurance. You also in the Islamic life insurance, you keep on paying a monthly, a certain amount. That amount which you give as monthly installment is invested in the Mudaraba system. Now whatever profit that you get from the money invested, a particular share, say 1/4 or 1/3 of that profit, you keep it separately as waqf. Your initial amount is invested in Mudaraba system. Whatever profit you have, 1/3 or 1/4, keep it separately as waqf. Now, if suppose any of the shareholders, any people who are involved with life insurance company which is Islamically based, if they have some problem like accident, you can give them medical aid from that waqf. And you can keep a fixed limit that if certain factor takes place, you'll give a certain amount. If that takes place an accident, you give a certain amount. If that takes place a disease, you give a certain amount. You can lay down the condition. Islam gives you permission that you're allowed to utilize your own waqf money, since it's part of your profit, which is pooled. But there can be loopholes. In the modern system of life insurance company that you have to pay monthly installment. And if you stop paying the monthly installment, all your previous money is gone. It is null and void. They do not give a single pie back. If you stop paying the monthly installment, the premium, all your previous money that were put in the life insurance corporation, it is forfeited. Islam does not allow you to forfeit anyone else's money. But if you don't have this rule, people will invest in the life insurance company according to the Sharia. Say if it's for 5 years, 6 years, they may stop paying after 5 months or 6 months. So you can make a format that anyone who invests, the scheme should be for approximately 5 years or 7 years or 10 years. If you stop paying anytime in between, you will only get your capital sum after 5 years, after 10 years, keep a fixed period. You start paying today. After 5 months, you stop paying. You will not get your money back immediately. You will only get after 5 years, after 10 years, whichever has been laid down on the Sharia board of that company. And secondly, if you stop paying before reaching half the time stipulated, say the insurance policy is for 5 years or 10 years, if it's for 5 years, if you stop paying before 2.5 years, then all the profit of your money, which you paid for 1 year or 2 years, is forfeited. But the capital sum you'll get back after 5 years or after 10 years. But if you stop paying after half the time, you'll get the profit. So it is also very much viable. It's possible to run a life insurance company based on the Islamic Sharia. I hope that answers the question.
Now I'd call upon Professor Hamza Virani. To Shoaib, is it?
Yes.
Yeah, I'd call upon Dr. Shoaib to present. Any question? To present the vote of thanks.
I, on behalf of Islamic Research Foundation, first of all, thank God Almighty, and then all of you for having this beautiful session and followed by a question answer session also. Inshallah, next Sunday, same timing at 10:45 a.m., there will be a symposium on the subject of Was Christ Crucified, shared by Professor Hamza Virani and inshallah myself. There will be again a session on Saturday, a video cassette. Zafar Muqaddam will be delivering a lecture, inshallah, Saturday afternoon, 2:45 p.m. Those coming for the first time to the organization are requested to fill up the response card and can collect the free literature that we distribute from here. Thank you very much. Jazakallah khair.
On for the Saturday program, I'd like to clarify, we'll have the ladies sitting down the auditorium. Usually we have the Saturday programs, which will be more of a ladies-based program. We'll have the ladies in the auditorium down. And gents, we have made arrangements on the top. There'll be an audio-video connection. Of course, as usual, like at present, we have the ladies on the top. On Sundays, we have the gents down. It will be reversed on Saturdays, so that we invite more ladies are invited on Saturday. And topics we have which would be have more relevance and interest to sisters. And on Sundays we have a general topic for everyone. Thank you. Assalamu alaikum.
Allah, 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 All